Yeah, so thanks a lot for having me at this wonderful conference. Of course, we live in difficult times, so this is not an in-person conference, which is a bit sad. Hopefully, we all can meet again next year. But what I saw so far from the event, it really looks like an amazing event with wonderful speakers and great topics. So I'm really happy to be here to give this talk to you this morning. So the topic is digital sovereignty and free software and GPL and how this all connects together. This is a bit of a bigger, broader topic. So where I want to talk with you about that, and I hope that at the end we still have time for some questions and answers, because this is something that hopefully stimulates a lot of discussions in our community. As already mentioned, my name is Frank Karliczek. I'm a computer scientist, studied computer science in Tübingen in Germany here. Contributed to lots of different open source projects over the years, for way over 20 years now. Did a lot in the KDE community, where I also was a board member and organized events and did all kinds of things. And over the last few years, I really did more and more in the public sector to work with politicians. For example, I'm a fellow of the Open Forum Europe, which is an organization you might know. It's basically a lobby organization for open source at the European level. Also happy to be an advisor to the United Nations regarding the intellectual property policy in open source. But most of you might know me, as mentioned before, as the founder of OwnCloud and Nextcloud, the successor. But today I don't want to really talk about Nextcloud. I really think that it's a good opportunity in our community to talk a little bit about bigger topic, what we want to achieve here as a free software and open source community. So as an agenda, I want to talk a little bit about the cloud first, what it means, where the term actually comes from, which I find interesting. Then a little bit about the term digital sovereignty. That's a relatively new term that some of you might have heard already, what it means and why this is relevant. And then a little bit what we actually can do to achieve this digital freedom, digital sovereignty together. This is then relates to the GAIA-X project and some other initiatives. And then hopefully at the end, we still have time for some questions. So let's get started. Let's start with the cloud. Obviously, you all know that more and more organizations and companies and governments and individuals move to the cloud. We move our data, our application, lots of our computing that we do into the cloud. I'll come back to this later, what it actually means. But this is a trend you know for 10, 15 years. So the cloud is like the future of IT. That's what you read in the press, obviously. But the thing is that you also read a lot of critical things about the cloud in the press. For example, there's some research done. Most of the research shows that the biggest concern of the cloud or cloud computing is security. It's really like, is my data secure? Who has access to my data? What about vendor login? How does this all work? There's a lot of concern about that. Here's another example of some research that was done. It also shows that security and vendor login are the top concerns of cloud users. And again, this is by home users, this is by governments, and it's also by companies, so basically all cloud users. Here's another example. This is just another survey of the users. They're asked, okay, what are the three most important public cloud concerns? And again, number one is security, compliance, the network latency a little bit, then like vendor login, compatibility and lots of other things. But cloud security is definitely one of the critical topics here. So if you're German, if you follow the German news, there was a big story last week actually at Der Spiegel, a big news publication, which reported that the German federal government alone just is paying Microsoft 178 million euros alone for IT services. I mean, of course, they say here that this is for software, but of course, as you all know, the Microsoft strategy nowadays is cloud computing. So lots of that is actually to pay for cloud services. And this is a big trend, and this is a lot of money. So a lot of people nowadays realize that this might be a problem, this new trend, we move everything to the cloud with all the security and vendor locking concerns. And this basically spin off the term or created the term digital sovereignty. That's something that was is really talked about a lot in the last 1-2 years. And this is basically a reaction to this cloud trend. And I looked up some definition, what it actually means. Let's go through it quickly. Of course, this is like, in my opinion, like the official definition. If you ask Microsoft, they actually have a different definition of that. Obviously, they're trying to fight this term and with their marketing. But I would say that the official definition of digital sovereignty is that digital sovereignty or cyber sovereignty is the degree of control an individual organization or government has over the data that generate and work with at local or online platforms. And it's basically being control of your data, of your digital future. That's digital sovereignty. And if you don't have digital sovereignty, there are some problems associated with it, some strategic risks. And here just some of them. First is loss of control over data represents a strategic risk for our society. Individuals, businesses, or governments are surveilled, and the data is monetized by foreign corporations. And that's obviously a problem because you really want to store your data, your applications in these cloud services. But instead, what happens is actually that this data is used by other players to surveil people, to monetize it with advertising and do other things that you don't really want. But that's like the consequence, the result of this cloud computing. And this is obviously something that threatens digital sovereignty. Another strategic risk is when societal debates take place on platforms owned by corporations and hosted in countries which are vested interests, how can we trust the results? Right? This is this whole political discussion. If like our personal digital lives moves more and more into the internet, into clouds, then we really rely on them, that we know what's happening, that it's basically under control, that it follows our laws and so on. But this is just happening in the cloud somewhere without our control. Then that's obviously a big problem. Again, digital sovereignty is not guaranteed here then. Another thing is when nearly all commerce flows through a few selected platforms, these platforms control the price and capture most value. So that's a more the business aspect here, right? So if basically the fundamental infrastructure where our business, our companies work are like hosted somewhere else under different laws with different interests, obviously this is a big threat for the economy of a lot of states. We are just completely rely on different country to have a prosperous economy, obviously. And then the last thing is about innovation. Innovation on new technologies in machine learning and big data analysis depends on vast data treasures that are not available to domestic businesses. Yeah, I mean, if you don't really have control about this infrastructure, about the data that is stored in these clouds, then it's possible that you can't innovate anymore in the future, right? Because if you want to do something with machine learning, artificial intelligence, you need like training data. And if the training data is just stored somewhere else, you don't have access to it, it follows different laws, different rules, then that's obviously a big problem. also another threat for digital sovereignty. So the good news is that this threat is seen by politicians nowadays. So I'm sometimes speak with politicians in Germany or in France or from the European Commission or in other states, mainly in Europe. They basically see this as a threat. They see this as a threat to our digital sovereignty, and they really think that something needs to be done here. And that's something new. That's something that popped up the last 1 or 2 years, as I mentioned. Honestly, probably also a little bit triggered by the president of the US in the last few years, which made it clear that maybe it's a bad idea to completely depend on the goodwill of another state. So digital sovereignty is a big topic, a big term discussed in politics a lot, especially in Europe. That's, for me, this is of course a little bit funny to see these discussions now popping up, because the whole idea is not new. It's actually very, very old. The whole idea of being in control of your software, of your data, of your digital life, being digital sovereign, is something that other people talked about for a long, long time. For example, there's this guy who talked about this whole problems like 35 years ago already. And of course, you all recognize that this is Richard Stallman. And he basically talked about these problems like 35 years ago, literally, so a long time ago. Of course, this was in a context, the world was a little bit different, so in a different context. So what he talked about are the four freedoms. That's something he postulated in the 80s. So the first freedom, in his opinion, is the freedom to run the program as you wish for any purpose. Of course, this came from a world where running a program means running a program on your local machine that is sitting on your desk. Right? There were no cloud computing or software as a service at the time. The internet was not really developed at the time, not as now. So basically running this application was running it on your machine that is sitting on your desk. But of course, it still means that if you should be able to run a program for any purpose as you wish, because then you're in control, because then you can run the program. The thing is, if the program is running in the cloud on a different server somewhere else, then you're not really in control anymore, right? And that's, of course, a problem. And you don't really decide which cloud application is running where. You can maybe not run it locally because it's just software as a service. You can use it or not use it, but you can't really control where the program is executed. For example, you can't run it locally. So, the first freedom that he postulated here is already violated by most cloud services. And it's violating the principle of digital sovereignty. The second freedom is the freedom to study how a program works and change it as you wish. And obviously, if you're just using some cloud service, if you're using Office 365 from Microsoft or Dropbox or some AWS APIs, you can't really study the software, right? You just use the API, you use the features, the service, you pay for it, and that's it. You can't really study it. The whole idea that he had at the time, that there should be the right, the freedom to study the applications, you don't have that. The third is the freedom to redistribute copies so you can help your neighbors. That's, of course, a bit funny, right? At the time, you had to help your neighbors with giving them floppy disks, I guess. Nowadays, everything is on the internet, connected. But if you can't really redistribute the AWS API, if you can't really redistribute the Dropbox service or source code or application, then you don't have this freedom. Right? This is what is meant here. This is really what is meant, that this gives you a freedom, and you definitely don't have this with modern cloud services. And the fourth, of course, the freedom to distribute copies of your modified version, right? This means that you have the source code, you have complete access to the software itself, and you can change it. And then once you change it, you can redistribute. Again, that's something that he wrote down in a world where this means distributing floppy disks. But if you adapt this to the modern world, to cloud services, again, this is not really guaranteed. So I really think that Richard Stallman here completely understood the problems already, and the four freedoms are still something we should have nowadays. Obviously, the world is a little bit different. So at a time, it was quite simple. You had hardware, you had a computer that you can buy or you get from your university or your employer or something, but it's a machine, usually without network, right? It's just a machine, and you can get it and you put it on your desk or under your desk or something, and that's just hardware. And then if you install software in it, and in this case, free software or open source software, then the combination of your hardware together with free software gives you complete digital sovereignty, right? Because then the data is stored on the local hard disk or the local floppies or whatever, and you control the software and you control the hardware, and then you're, as a result, you're in control of your complete digital life. So this was the world at the time. Of course, nowadays, the world looks a little bit more complex. So nowadays, the question is if this equation is still true, that you have hardware plus software means digital sovereignty. Of course, as you can imagine with this question mark, I think this equation is no longer true, because nowadays you need more additional components to be in control of your digital lives. The first is data. So to give you an example, let's say Microsoft, who is running the Office 365 or Microsoft 365 service nowadays, and they run it on their servers, on their cloud infrastructure, and the software is proprietary. It's not open source free software, obviously. But let's assume you buy yourself some servers. You buy the hardware. It's possible. You can go to some shop and buy some hardware, right? And then let's assume Microsoft open sources their complete software. Then the classic free software movement would say, yeah, victory, great, awesome. Now we have the software. Now we have won. The problem is that we might not have access to the data, right? Because maybe the data is just stored in the Microsoft cloud, and it needs to be there because you want to collaborate with others somehow. And you don't really have a digital sovereignty because you don't have access to the data. So that's a problem. So I think for complete digital sovereignty, you actually need three things: hardware, software, and data, and only then you're in control. Which led to something like that. It's called the User Data Manifesto. That's an initiative of some people, me together with some other free software people. A few years ago, we came up with this User Data Manifesto. You can think about it as the GPL for data or something. It basically defines what people should be allowed to do with their data. First of all, the user should be in control of their data. So if it's my data, if it's my document, my pictures, my chat messages, everything, that I should be in control of that. I should be able to decide who has access to the data and who not. Second is I should have the knowledge where my data is actually stored, right? It's just floating around in the cloud somewhere. That's not good, right? It's my data. I want to know where are my pictures, who has access to the pictures, who can read my chat messages, and so on. And the third one is the freedom to choose a platform, right? Because if you no longer want to give my data to like one service provider, I want to be able to migrate to another service provider. And it should be very easy. There should be open APIs and open specifications for that you can just move your application and your data around. So that's obviously, I think, a missing component to reach like full digital sovereignty. But let's give you another example. Let's say you want to have one of those modern self-driving cars, but you want to have this with complete digital sovereignty. Okay. So let's think that, for example, you want to buy, I don't know, a Tesla or something, but you want to have the Tesla being complete control of what's happening there. Then again, what do you need? You need a hardware. That's relatively easy. You can go to a shop and buy the car. Then you have the hardware, Okay. Then let's assume that Tesla is nice and open sources their complete software tomorrow. Then you can study the software, you can install the software in your car, and it's all nice. The problem is nowadays, cars and lots of other applications, they actually use machine learning. And machine learning requires training data. So let's assume you get the software, you get the hardware, but you don't have a self-driving car. It's useless. You're not in control. You can't even use it yourself. Because what you need, first, you need to have the training data to do the machine learning to then have a self-driving car. Okay? So this means that you really need, going back, you really need hardware and software and data nowadays for complete digital sovereignty. But I want to go one step further, because I think there might be another component, right? There's another component that you need for complete digital sovereignty. For example, let's look into social networking. Let's say Facebook is very nice, and they're also open source their complete source code tomorrow, okay? Then again, great, because I can buy some hardware, just buy a server, put it at home in my basement, fine. Then I get this nice new open source software from Facebook. It's available, free software. You take it, install it in this machine, nice. Then you take the data. Maybe I have all my chat messages and my pictures and all my status messages and all my stuff there. And I just also put it on this machine. Okay, great. Do I have digital sovereignty now? Not really, because my own social network at home where I'm the only user is a bit lonely, right? If I'm the only user there, it doesn't really help. So you really want to connect this to other users. You actually want to have something like the cloud. That's something, I mean, for social networking, if it's communication, for example, then basically isolating your system from others is not very helpful for communication. So something like the cloud is actually sometimes useful. So now I want to basically talk a little bit about the cloud, where I think it's coming from and what it means. Some of you might wonder where the term cloud comes from. Cloud, like what's that? What has a cloud something to do with IT? So I did some research, and my theory is actually it came from diagrams like that. If you're like a little bit older like me, then you still remember like the 90s. And if you remember, if you worked in IT in the 90s, then maybe you remember some of those PowerPoint slides, something like that, where people were demonstrating their infrastructure. Right? This is an example where you can see, hey, here's a computer, here's a fax machine, here's a telephone, here's some other laptop, something. And then that's all connected with these red network cables. And then on the left, you see this cloud. Okay. So this is one of the, this cloud was one of the clip outs from PowerPoint. And I think this is actually where the term coming from. And this cloud meant, okay, here's something more. Here's other stuff that's also connected to my network, but it's somewhere else. I don't know it. It's running out of my control. It's somewhere else. I don't really care, but it is there and it's interacting with my system somehow. I think this is actually where the term is coming from. Or another example is this network diagram, also from the 90s. There you can see a bunch of servers and network switches and other components. And again, there is this cloud. This is this clip out from PowerPoint. I see, okay, this whole infrastructure is actually connected to something else, to the internet, to some other services. But there, I no longer know what kind of cables and hard disk and switches are in there. It's just cloudy, right? I don't really understand it, but it is definitely there and it's connected and it wouldn't work without it. Of course, nowadays, the cloud looks a little bit different. Nowadays, the cloud is actually huge. So the cloud has like lots of applications, lots of data, lots of infrastructure. And our local network, as you can see here, tiny on the right-hand side, are just like very small, tiny components are basically just access terminals to the cloud in a way. And so this is unfortunately how the world looks nowadays. Of course, as you might know, the cloud is actually not this cloudy thing, because there are actually hardware behind it. Right? There is this term also from the FSFE that there is no cloud, it's just someone else's computer. It's exactly how it is. Right? This cloudy clipboard doesn't mean that there is nothing in it. Of course, there's the full infrastructure in it. It's just someone else's infrastructure and I don't really know it. So that's the problem here. Okay, so where is this cloud? Where is this cloud? Because it is not in the sky, right? It's some server somewhere. I took like a world map and I tried to basically identify where this cloud really is in the world, because it must be somewhere. It is hardware. I was relatively fast because most of the cloud is actually there. So this is California, this is Silicon Valley, a little bit north in Seattle. There you see Amazon and Microsoft, but it's basically, this is like where all the cloud, all the infrastructure is, okay? And this is the situation where we're living in. And this is where the term digital sovereignty is so critical, because we really depend on some infrastructure running by some people we don't really control somewhere else, and we are not really in control of our IT anymore. So digital sovereignty, how can we get there? How can we achieve that? Because that's a free software conference here, and as I mentioned, free software is a key to digital sovereignty, but it's not the only component. We need a little bit more. So I, to finish up my talk, I wanted to inspire you to talk a little bit about what we can actually do to reach digital sovereignty again, as we had in the 80s, where we had our computers on desk together with the free software. So what do we actually need? So what are the components to reach digital sovereignty? I think the first thing we need is there should be a rich and decentralized infrastructure where these IT services can run. Okay, and this means that sometimes this infrastructure is in my basement. Maybe sometimes I decide to run it myself, okay? Or in my company or university or my soccer club or whatever, right? But if I want to run it locally, that should be possible. But if you want to run it like hosted by somewhere else in the cloud, this should also be possible. And that's fine, that's just an option. But it is important that there are not only three providers in the world. There should be like millions of different providers where you can choose. And there should be very small, and there should be very big ones. You should be able to choose where you want to host your applications and your data. And then that's actually fine. And of course, you should be able to migrate between them, obviously. And this kind of infrastructure should be really decentralized, and there should be providers in every region of the world. So it's not really good to have decentralization. Okay. And this is actually where I'm happy that we have this initiative called Gaia-X in the EU at the moment, which tries to help here a little bit. So Gaia-X, what is it? It is actually an initiative by the German government, by the French government, and many other European governments at the moment. It's mainly a European initiative. The idea is to build a decentralized cloud infrastructure. Okay, so the idea is not to build like one big European cloud. The idea is to connect all those different smaller cloud providers together into one virtual cloud, basically make it completely interoperable. And this together then should be an alternative to cloud service from the US and China mainly. There are like 200 members already, from very small to very big. And together, this is this initiative to build this. The idea is to have open standards, interoperable standards between the different cloud providers to basically enable everybody to offer those services. There is also a little bit of a commitment to do everything as open source and free software. I have this in brackets here because there are still ongoing discussions. I have lots of discussions with people and politicians about that, where I would stress that it needs to be free software, otherwise it's useless. But there's still a fight going on to basically have the full commitment that full Gaia-X should be open source. Just to be clear, I don't want to sound like a fan of that. It's just an interesting initiative. I'm actually very happy that the politicians understand the need for that. To reach digital sovereignty, you need to have a better decentralized local cloud infrastructure and not depend on three big players somewhere else. But of course, this is a project that is pushed forward by many organizations, and let's see how it goes. But it has a lot of potential. The second thing I think we need to reach full digital sovereignty is that you always have to have the choice between on-premise and off-premise solutions. So on-premise, of course, means hosted yourself in some data center, some server, something you own, you control. And off-premise means to give it to someone else, to pay someone else to do the services for you, which is totally fine in some situations, but you should have the choice. It's not good if some services only exist on as software as a service and don't exist as real free software that you can install yourself anymore. So it really should be on-premise or off-premise, you should be able to choose. The third requirement for full digital sovereignty, in my opinion, is it really needs to be free software. And I don't have to repeat it. You know, I think everybody here who is listening knows the benefits of free software and open source. Really, as I mentioned before, you can study the software, you can learn from it, you can innovate on top of it, you can check if there are any backdoors, you can use it for any purpose, and so on and so on. So free software, open source is absolutely key requirement for that. This is why all the important components, there should be free software alternatives. And now comes the one slide pitch for Nextcloud, obviously. Sorry, I can't help myself. So with Nextcloud, we try to help in some area. So we try to provide an alternative to the services from Google and Microsoft and Dropbox and others, basically the application layer. So the full collaboration suite with Office and File and Chat and Video Calling, Groupware and so on, that you can run on-premise, off-premise, where you want, as 100% open source. So that's something we try to do. But of course, at the end, what you really want is not like one implementation, not only Nextcloud, but you want to have like different implementations for every component of the stack, right? So basically what you really need is different open source projects or different open source companies providing different pieces of the stack, and they're all exchangeable. And maybe you sometimes decide to use that one, then you decide to use another one. And this is how it should be, that you can choose between them. Maybe it's also fine to have some proprietary alternatives too, but there should be at least several free software open source implementations too. I think this is really, really important for digital sovereignty. So what you really need is this rich free software product ecosystem that you can choose between different things. One of the challenges I want to mention quickly here is the challenge of surveillance capitalism. That's actually an interesting situation that if you're doing open source and free software for a long time, as me, then you remember that in the 90s and 2000s, when, I don't know, Linux distributions or LibreOffice or Firefox and others that tried to compete against the proprietary solutions, we always had the benefit to be like the more free as in freedom solution, but we were also free as in VR. Nowadays, it's unfortunately a bit more complicated because lots of those cloud services you also get for free. Because they do surveillance capitalism, right? They look into your data, they sell you advertising, they sell your data to all kinds of other things you don't want, but that's something that's happening. So this, unfortunately, has the weird effect that open source and free software is no longer cheaper. Actually, in some cases, it is more expensive because let's look at Nextcloud, for example. So Nextcloud is free. You don't have to pay for it, sure, but you need to run it somewhere. You need to have a server or some cloud infrastructure, some storage, some compute, some networking, and so on to run it. And you have to pay for that. But if you use like the free version from Google or, I don't know, from Facebook, you don't have to pay for it. Actually, you pay with your data. So in an interesting way, proprietary software like the one from Google is now cheaper than free software. So that's something to overcome. It's a bit of a problem, to be honest. The next requirement I want to point out is open standards. So I mentioned that we want to have different implementations that can be provided and that can be replaced to each other. And it's really important that we all follow the same open standards, because only then software components can be replaced. And this is like for everything. This should be like for basic cloud services, social networking, productivity, infrastructure like AWS, APIs, for all the components. That's really something we need to do. Also on a political level, to make this mandatory, that there are actually laws that certain IT systems need to follow open standards. I think this is not happening automatically by market forces. I think there are really laws needed to make this mandatory. And then the last thing I wanted to point out is I think we should have like stronger laws how data is handled. And this is like privacy rights. I think we still need to have stronger privacy rights. In Europe, we have the GDPR, which is a good step forward. But I think there should be more regulations and rules how our privacy and our data is handled. And then the second thing is, of course, data portability. This is actually funny, because data portability is part of the GDPR, but this is widely ignored. I don't know really know why, but the GDPR actually requires that you can export your data from one service and import it into another service. So that's definitely something that is really key to reach like full digital sovereignty. Okay, now I'm getting to the end of my talk. Let's go to the summary already. I think digital sovereignty is a mandatory thing for a free and open society. If you just imagine that you're not in control of your digital life, you don't know what's happening with your data, with your communication, everything is controlled by someone else, and you have no legal rights to do something, you can't really influence it, you can't innovate on top of it, you can't change it, then this is not a free and open society anymore. So your digital sovereignty for individuals and for companies and for governments is mandatory. It's really important. And I think we are builders of these tools. We are engineers. We build this kind of internet services, this software. I mean, this is a software conference here, right? So we have the obligation to shape the future of IT, of computing, in a way that that enables us all to live in a free and open society again in 20, 30, 50 years. And we have to opportunity to do that because we have the tools, but we really also have to do that. The internet and the cloud are, this is all built by engineers, right? The internet is not nature, right? This is all human beings, which also means that other human beings like us can change it. And we have to do that. And free software and open source is really the key to that. It's no longer just like, yeah, it would be nice to look into the source code. No, it's a fundamental human right, fundamental requirement for a free society, mandatory for digital sovereignty to have like free software implementations of all important components. So thanks a lot. This was my talk. And now I think we might have still 5 minutes for questions, I hope.
Yes, thank you so much, Frank, for that talk. That was wonderful. Yeah, we have a few questions coming in. I see some that are on a similar topic, so I'll read these two out together. The first one is, the Russian government wants to control social networks. In Belarus, the power in force just said that people should stop using smartphones because the USA is spying on them. Do you think that digital sovereignty would be just another term to lock control over media inside countries' borders so that everybody could be punished by those who are in power? And there's another similar question that's, how do you see the concern Yulia Reda raised yesterday that the term digital sovereignty might also give room to nationalism? What can be done about this?
Yes, they are definitely connected, the two things. This is a bit of a of a tricky thing, because if you have a new term like digital sovereignty, people try to frame the meaning of it in different ways. For example, you have a you have the Microsoft of the world who say, well, if you buy Microsoft products, then you did a sovereign decision. You like Microsoft, you buy it, and then you're digital sovereign because you buy it. That's of course a complete spin of the meaning, which is totally not the meaning of itself. In the same way, I think if a government like Russia or China too decided to basically control all the services inside the country by the government and then call it digital sovereignty, then this is also like a spin and change of the meaning. Because digital sovereignty doesn't mean that the government can do what they want. It also means that every human being can do what they want, right? It's not like, I mean, we have human rights, right? And we all are humans, and we are all have human rights. But governments don't have human rights, right? Governments are just tools for the people, right? So digital sovereignty is something for the people and for everybody to control their digital life. So, and if everybody's in control, that this is not nationalism, right? Of course, I completely agree with Julia that we are living in this interesting times where different organizations and are spinning terms in different directions. So it's definitely, at least in my opinion, doesn't mean that somehow, I don't know, there should be like a big firewall of Europe in the same way, big firewall of China. This has absolutely nothing to do with the meaning of digital sovereignty.
So you think we should be very clear with what we mean by sovereignty when we use this term?
Yeah, I think so. But it is a bit of a, that's always how it is with new words, right? People that try to spin it as they want, unfortunately.
Okay, we have a couple more questions. One of them is, are you familiar with the unhosted organization who have been working since 2010? Yes, and they predicted a lot of current discussions on sovereignty and digital. So yeah. you're aware of them? Yeah.
I absolutely. Actually, some of the core members are friends of mine, and we work together. And for example, Michael, I think, which is the founder, at least one of the core people, we work together on implementing some things in Xcloud at the moment. And also Jan, who did the whole UI UX of Unhosted, is also now doing the UI and UX of Nextcloud. So yeah, they're friends, and we share the same values and same ideas, I think I can say. And we definitely work together.
Okay, great. We have time for one more as well. Do you see the way how to make the costs of surveillance capitalism? So you pay with your... Okay, sorry, let me read this again. Do you see a way to make the costs of surveillance capitalism that you pay with your data more visible to users so that it's clear that these services are not free?
Yeah, this is one of the big questions, right? I think I like the question because it is, I like the way this is the direction of this question. I don't have an answer, to be honest. I'm thinking about this a lot, what we can do here. It's really a tough challenge and tough nut to crack. If someone has an idea how to do that, happy to help. I don't have a good answer. I'm sorry.
Okay.
But it's exactly the dilemma. I agree with the question, but I don't have an answer.